bless you because you have been the front, and I want that you can see what we can see with the oceans and everything, the storms raging around the young lady and how she was able to overcome. And I think what was really good is that when Jesus sat down and when she was just about to get her breakthrough, the storms raged even more. So sometimes it shows that when your breakthrough is about to come, the storms are really running. So the worship team is going to sing for us one more time, Spirit Break Out, whilst we get the worship ready for our preacher, Pastor Jerome, to come up to us.
Just on the verge of something. We're just going to break it into God's presence. desire, Lord, more than anything, for your Holy Spirit to break out in our lives, Lord. To break out in this church, Lord. To break out in this community, Lord. To break out in our world, Lord. Father, Lord, we pray that there will not be things in our hearts, Lord, things in our lives that will be barriers, that will be walls, Lord, for you breaking out into this world, Lord. Father, we desire for your kingdom to come now. And we pray, Lord, that as we spend these few minutes around your word, Lord, that you'll speak to us, God. That you inspire us, God. That you encourage us. You'll comfort us, God. Because ultimately, Lord, we desire for heaven to meet earth and for your will to be done. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Everybody said,
amen.
Everybody said,
amen.
Give a couple people a high five and you go sit down. If you have your Bibles, then please turn to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. It's a pleasure to be here this morning for two reasons. The first reason is because I got to see one of my best friends. I probably know him since I was born, basically. And to see him dedicate his daughter was absolutely an amazing thing. And a great testimony to see, and I know there's people in the house this morning that have been on that journey. So I'm so grateful to be here for that. The second reason is even if it's just for one morning, I'm back home. Me and Leanne and Josh, we're leading a youth ministry in Lewisham called Fearless, and it's going really well. A lot of great stuff, open up some great doors, and we've got a couple of young people with us today, Sapphire and Necro. They're amazing women of God, and they're serving God with their whole life, and they're an example actually to young people in Lewisham, what it looks like to be sold out, and what it looks like to be fearless for Jesus, and so these guys are completely amazing. And the last thing is that I just want to just greet and just say hello and to the senior leaders of the house. Thank you so much for allowing me to speak. It's a massive privilege. And once I've done all of that spiel, have you found Daniel 3? Who's not found Daniel 3 yet? Can't hardly ask. Daniel 3, I'm just going to read a couple of verses. We're going to read verses 16 and 18. I'll read from the Message version, but you can still follow in your own Bible. It says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered King Nebuchadnezzar, your threat means nothing to us. If you throw us in the fire, the God we serve can rescue us from your roaring furnace and anything else you might cook up, O King. This is the bit I just want us to focus on over the next couple of minutes that I share with you. It's this thing of, but even if he doesn't, it wouldn't make a bit of difference, okay? We still wouldn't serve your gods or worship the gold statue you set up. The title of my talk this morning is simply, even if, dot, dot, dot. Say to the person next to you, even if, dot, dot, dot. Do you have any pet lovers? Any pet lovers? Any people that love pets? Animals? So, if you've got a cat, lift up your hand. If you've got a cat. If you've got a hamster, anybody got a hamster? Rabbit? Anybody got any fish? This is a big one. Anybody got a dog? Yeah. I absolutely hate dogs. But it's appropriate for why I hate dogs. I'll tell you why I hate dogs. When I was coming home from school one day, me and my friend, we were walking, and we were having a conversation, we were talking, and I met my friend's older brother, and he had a dog with him. Now, I was a bit to me, unsure, because to be fair, I don't really know my friend's older brother. I also don't know my friend's older brother's dog. So he thought it would be 100% A-class banter, 100% A-class jokes to let the dog off his leash. And the dog began to chase us. Me and my friends. Now this is the thing. I've always been tall and I've always been big, which means I'm not very fast when I'm on the ground. But on this day, some pace kicked up in my legs and some speed, and I thought to myself, I felt like a butterfly sting like a bee. This dog will not eat me. And guys, I would 100% lose to in a race. I was just skipping past that. And when I reflect on that story and I think back on why I hate dogs, I realized that actually there was a moment in that episode and that season of my life where I was actually unsure about how things were going to turn out. I was a little bit uncertain about whether I was going to be a dog's dinner or not. I wasn't sure whether I was going to make it or if I wasn't going to make it. See, I believe this morning that there are some people in this room this morning that actually they're sitting in the same space. Where they're in a situation or they're in a season or an episode of their life where they're not 100% sure how things are going to turn out. They're not 100% sure whether they're going to be a dog's dinner or not. They just don't know if they're going to make it or not. And this is the thing, it's so easy to trust God when life is going well and you know how things are going to turn out. It's so easy. But rarely in life do we know how things are going to turn out. I actually believe that life is a little bit like British weather. You can never trust it, and you never know which season you're going to get at which time. And so it just becomes incredibly hard to trust God, because actually you're uncertain about the outcome of the situation. See, this morning we're jumping into a story, we're jumping into the lives of these three guys who found themselves in a situation where they were unsure about the outcome of the situation. They found themselves in a space where they weren't certain whether they were going to make it or whether they weren't going to make it. And we have the luxury as people in 2016 to simply look down at the rest of the chapter and read what's happened. We have the luxury to simply turn the page and say, oh, they made it out there. We have the luxury to take the remote control and fast forward it to the end of the episode to see what's going to happen. But these guys didn't have that luxury. Verse 16 and 18, they're in a space where they don't know how things are going to turn out. And I would ask you this morning for the next couple of minutes, if you would put yourselves in their shoes. Why? Because you're standing in their place, in a situation where you're unaware how things are going to turn out, where you're unaware whether you're going to make it or whether you're not going to make it. So you might ask, how do we get to this place? And for those that come to church a lot and have been a part of the body of Christ for ages, and this story might be simply a bit hazy in your memory, and for those this is your first time and you have no clue who these three guys are, I'm just going to bring us up to speed on how we got here. So King Nebuchadnezzar decided to invade Israel. And he decided to take some of the best people in Israel, some of the highest people. And that was Daniel and his three guys. And so he takes them back to Babylon. And what's interesting enough, when he takes them back there, he changes their name. And I find that very interesting and very relevant for where the church is at this present time. Because it's not the fact that they changed their name, but it's the fact that they accepted that their name got changed. And they began to call themselves the name that they were given. And I actually think, I mean, when you look over church history, the church has swung from one side of the pendulum to the other. At some points in history, the church has been so a part of culture, and so a part of society, and so a part of the state, that actually it's become irrelevant. And you don't know the difference between God and the government. But there's been other times where it's swung to the other side, where it's been so separate from society, so separate from the state and culture, that it becomes irrelevant. And actually, They're not able to speak into the culture. What these guys were actually doing is they were taking on the Babylonian culture. See, I actually believe that as a church, we should take the language of our culture and fill it with the content of Christ. We should understand the music that they have, understand the technology that they use, understand how people relate to each other, how people communicate to each other. Because I think sometimes what we've done is that we've taken the content of Christ and just hope that our culture will understand. We need to converse with our culture. I know that the Pentecostal movement, when it first came in, it came with a strong sense of holiness. And that actually, at the beginning of it, has been interpreted as separation. But that's not the definition of holiness. It's to be set apart. And I look for scripture and I read the Gospels and I realize it's not separation that brought salvation, but it was the incarnation that brought salvation. It was God putting on humanity. It was God coming into the world. It was God coming into our difficult situations and bringing salvation. And so if we are supposed to be the church that reflects and represents Jesus, then we have to speak the language that our culture is speaking. All the stories that Jesus told, they were told to farmers, and he used farming examples. Because that was the audience, and he knew that he had to communicate to the audience in a way that they could understand. And so I see this here, and I see that these guys were not afraid to take on the Babylonian culture because they knew that they wanted to communicate to the culture Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what we need to do as a church. But as we continue, these guys, the name of change, they accept it, and then a group of people manage to convince Nebuchadnezzar to build an idol. Not just any idol, but a really, really tall idol. Actually, some scholars say it was one of the tallest on his day. When they used to look at some of the other idols of the time, they wouldn't even come close to that. And so he's built this massive gold statue. And he has an expectation that when the trumpet sounded, everybody that would hear that would then stop what they were doing and bow down to the idol. And this expectation, it included these three boys. King Nebuchadnezzar had an expectation that they would bow and worship the idol. But this is the issue if they would bow. If they would bow, it meant they would be turning their back on what they believed in, they would be turning their back on God, and they would be giving in to the pressure of the situation. I wonder if I could talk metaphorically for a couple of minutes. I actually believe that some of the situations and circumstances that we find ourselves in have the exact same mindset as King Nebuchadnezzar. When they desire for you to bow, when they desire you to turn your back on what you believe in, to turn your back on God, and to give into the pressure of your situation. Hey, illness, it asks you, will you turn your back on what you believe in? Cancer asks you, will you turn your back on God? Cancer says, hey, will you give in to the pressure of the situation that you find yourself in? Will you bow to the king that is cancer? Hey, maybe your friends, they're asking you, they're asking you to compromise your life, compromise the purity that you've decided to live your life by. And they ask you, will you turn your back on God? Will you turn your back on the things you believe in? Will you give in to the pressure of the situation you find yourself in? Will you bow to the king of acceptance? Or maybe you've been disappointed. I know that me and Leanne, we've been really over the last 2 years, we've been deeply disappointed with the situation that we found ourselves in. But disappointment asks you, will you turn your back on God? Will you turn your back on what you believe in? Will you give in to the pressure of the situation you found yourself in? Will you bow to the king of disappointment? Or maybe somebody offended you. Somebody you trusted and they betrayed you. They didn't fulfill the expectation that you wanted them to fulfill. Hey, maybe somebody was on a bad day and said a sharp word to you and you thought, who are you talking to? And then you fester that and keep that in your heart. And offense asks you this question. Will you turn your back on God? Will you give in to the pressure of the situation you find in? Will you turn your back on the things you believe in? Will you bow to the king of offense? See, we all have kings in our lives that are asking or demanding for you to bow. But I'm here this morning to slightly encourage you believer, I hope it's a massive encouragement that there is a king that tells those kings to bow down. There's a king that tells those kings that I'm the king, I'm the real king. Not just because I'm a king, but I'm the king of kings. I guess my question to you this morning is this: what will be your response? What will be your response when the king of disappointment and offense and cancer and acceptance and rejection, what will be your response when they ask you to bow? Well, these guys, they had a response. And their response was this: even if God doesn't save me, I'm still not going to bow. Even if the cancer's not cured, I'm still not going to bow. Even if my friends, they completely abandon me, I'm still not going to bow. Even if I'm disappointed to the core of my heart, I'm still not going to bow. Even if I'm offended and people have talked bad about me, I'm still not going to bow. See, the day and age that we live in at the moment, where vehicles are going into crowds, where bombs are going into football stadiums, where people are coming into churches, we need an even if faith. We need an even if faith. See, because even if faith is ugly, even if faith is stealing, even if faith is honest, even if faith is gritty, and it says, even if I don't know the outcome of the situation I find myself in, I'm still not going to bow. Even if faith is more relevant in our situation than we would like to believe. Because we would love to believe that that can happen in France. But France is an hour away. We would love to believe that that can happen in Germany. But Germany is what, maybe an hour and a half away. And this is not about fear. Because I believe that actually sometimes we can watch TV, we can watch these videos, and fear begins to build up. People start making decisions. Oh, I was going to go to Germany, but I'm not going to go anymore. I was going to go to America, but I'm not going to go anymore. Now I understand that, but we can't live a life that is driven by fear. See, the truth is, fear is a lie. It creates a reality for you that keeps you where you are. And God doesn't desire for you to live a life of fear. He desires you to live a life of even if faith. See, I think there's a couple of lessons that we can learn from these three guys about the situation they found themselves in. Because they get thrown into the fire. And I mean, there's three lessons that we can learn. And I've got 7 minutes to do these three lessons. Because I don't want to keep you too long. And the first lesson is this: despite the heat, they stayed on their feet. Despite the heat, they stayed on their feet. So we're told in verse 25 that they were walking around the furnace. And this is the thing, there's so many occasions in scripture where we're told to stand firm. We're told to stand and be on alert. But there's also times in scripture where God is also standing. And in 2 Timothy 4 verse 17, God is standing there. And Paul writes, he says, the first time I was brought before the church, no one came with me. Everyone abandoned me. May it not be counted against them. And here's verse 17. But the Lord stood with me and gave me strength so that I might preach the good news in its entirety to all the Gentiles to hear, and he rescued me from certain death. See, some scholars believe that the reason why God was standing was because he wanted to give encouragement and strength. See, the reason why you need to stand in your firmness is because you need to give encouragement and strength to other people. Other people get to look at you and say, wow, we got through that. Wow, they managed to move through that. They managed to stand because despite the heat, I'm going to stay on my feet. I'm not going to bow. I'm not going to curl up in the corner and say, woe is me. continue our lives thinking God has forsaken us and we're not going to serve him anymore, we lost our son. But we decided to say, hey, despite the heat, God, we're going to stand on our feet. And I know there's people in this house, and I've been here most of my life, and I can see people in here that actually their mantra has been, maybe not specifically this, but what they've been saying is, despite the heat, I'm going to stay on my feet. Second lesson that we can learn from these guys in there, furnace was, I won't talk it, I'll walk it. I won't talk it, I'll walk it. Remember, we're told that they were walking. And I actually believe that our culture and our society, I think they're fed up with hearing God is good and all the time God is good when everything is going good. See, they want to see, what do you say when things are going bad? What do you say when the plan isn't going to plan? When things are terrible? See, because there comes a point in every single believer's life where the Bible turns from being a fairy tale to a history book full of men and women who had even faith that said, I don't know the outcome, but I'm not going to bow. See, your faith, it cannot be truly trusted if it has never been truly tested. And some of the stuff that you're going through is God simply testing your faith. How flexible is your faith? Because if your faith is too rigid, then something that is harder than your faith will smash through it. How malleable is your heart? Hey, what about your character? Oh man, you've got a terrible boss. And all you do is come home and moan and moan and moan. What I've learned about God is when we pray for patience, he never gives us patience. He always gives us a situation to exercise patience. We can ask God, give us wisdom, but he's already given us wisdom and he wants you to exercise the wisdom, so he places you in a place where you can exercise wisdom. See, I won't just talk this thing, I'm going to walk it. And the truth is, when you're in the fire, I remember, I don't want to talk too much about the past, but I remember there was a message that Pastor Rawson preached, he said, and the essence of it was, whatever you do outside of the fire will have an impact on what you do inside of the fire. See, so the truth is that whatever's on the inside of you, that will come out. So when you're pressured and it's a bit stressful, if the sharp word comes out, it's because the sharp word was always in there. If you're pressured and things aren't going the way that you planned it to be, then, and maybe the moderator's not doing the things that you wanted to do, and the preacher's not saying the things that you want to say, and you go home and you complain, and oh man, that guy is always talking rubbish, oh, I can't wait till next week. Next week I'm sure it will be better. But what I'm saying is that you just get annoyed and you get a bit bitter. You know why? Because the bitterness was already in there. Because whatever's inside of you, it always comes out. So hey, right now, if you're not in the fire, work on your character. Hey, young people, do you know what? You ever have the pressures of paying bills and a mortgage and all of that type of stuff? But you know, you have the pressure of your GCSEs and your A-levels. And time after time, I see young people in this period of time of their life, and because it's A-levels or GCSEs, all of a sudden church attendance just goes down. This is the new pastor's heart talking. All of a sudden, God moves to the side. Hey, even parents turn around and say, oh, my son and daughter can't do that. But the first person you run to when your son and daughter are doing madness is who? Is the new pastor. Wanting him or her to have a magical conversation which will turn around the habits that you have allowed. See, that was a message to Lionel and Alyssa, what Pastor Spencer was saying about the house and the way that you live your life. And so, it doesn't really matter what age you are. Pressure is pressure. It's just different stages of life. And so I hope that as young people in the place that are not thinking, oh, this message is for the adults again. No, that's not. This message is for you. Because you know what? You can talk this thing, but there comes a moment where you might move to union. Are you going to walk in there? You might talk this thing within these four walls, and Mum might be sitting over there, But let's lift up your hands right now. Are you able to lift up your hands in your university ballroom, where there is no band, where there is no nice music, where there is no preacher telling you, come on, come on, God is good all the time? No, no, you don't have that. You just got that even if faith. I'm asking worship team to come back up and we're going to finish here. You can play softly in the background and you will feel God just descend in 3, 2, 1. There we go. See, the last one, the last lesson that we learned from these guys, the last lesson that we can learn from these guys is your fire can bring someone else freedom. Your fire can bring someone else freedom. See, we're told that these guys, that they make it out. Actually, Nebuchadnezzar, he asked them to come out because he's so amazed at what's happening in the fire. And we're told that King Nebuchadnezzar begins to worship God. See, it's what he observed in the fire that moved his heart. See, we have no idea who's watching our life. We have no idea of the people that are observing us. I guess the challenge to us today is, what are they observing? See, because whatever they're observing, it will either move them towards God or it will move them away from God. It will either move them towards freedom or it will move them towards slavery. See, because your fire can give someone else freedom. See, when you go for a fire, we're told that even their chains came off. So actually, your freedom leads to others' freedom. See, the fire that you're in at the moment is just not for no reason. The furnace you find yourself in is not just because God slept over his alarm and forgot to protect you this morning. It's not that. It's because there's a purpose behind it. And there's some freedom that needs to be experienced by someone else in your world. But there was another person that experienced fire. There's another person that decided, even if they reject me, even if they make mistakes, even if time after time I call them to be my sons and daughters, even if I will still die for the mistakes that you've made and give you freedom for the guilt and shame that you experience. And he's someone that looks like the Son of Man. Someone that King Nebuchadnezzar said he looks like the Son of God. But the truth is, he doesn't look like, he is the Son of God. And his name is Jesus Christ. And he is here today and he's asking you, hey, do you want freedom for the guilt and the shame that you experience? Do you want to know what living really is? Because I'm life. And I bring it to the fullest. So we're going to sing a song and I'm not going to labor on this point too much. But if you're in here, you've actually never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You've actually never made the decision to say, God, I'm sorry for the mistakes that I've made. And I want to live the way that you want me to live. And I'm thankful that you died for my mistakes. And now I want to take freedom. Now I want to experience freedom. Because Jesus' fire made your freedom. So if you're in here today, and some of the words that I've been speaking have touched your heart and touched your mind, then I want to ask, you don't know Jesus, to simply indicate by lifting up your hands. And we're going to pray for you. And we're going to pray salvation over your life. Because Jesus ultimately wants the best for you. And he has a plan for you as well. So. This break, 2016, 27th of February, our son Joshua Hall. What's really interesting is that Caleb's name means devotion, but Joshua means salvation. So I believe there's two groups of people in this room. There's those that need to be more devoted. There's those that need to be like Caleb and say, I'm going to devote my life to you fully. And then there's those that need some Joshua, some salvation in their life. And so I've got 2 more minutes. And it doesn't mean that if you miss these 2 minutes that you can't receive salvation. But hey, what better time than now? So if you're sitting here and you don't know God, then maybe you're sitting here and you did know God, but you decided to kind of walk away, or life took you on the waves of life and it took you just away from Him. Then I want to invite you to make that decision to say, God, I desire to have some Joshua. I want some salvation. I want to be saved. But if you're in here this morning and your fire has been getting harder and harder, and walking and standing becomes harder and harder, and you don't really see how your fire can lead to someone else's freedom, then I'm going to ask you to come forward. But I ask you to come forward because what you're saying is God, I'm going to be more devoted to you. God, I'm going to keep going. God, I'm not going to give up. Despite the heat, I'm going to stay on my feet. I'm just going to talk this thing. I'm going to walk it because I know that at the end of the day, I'm going to be free. And I know someone else will be free as well. So what I'm asking for this morning is not strength from God, but for you to put your faith even more into God. Because often when we pray for faith, doesn't give us more faith. He just puts you in the middle of the fire or the middle of the sea and says, are you going to trust me? So if that's you this morning, then I want you to just come forward and we're going to pray. And I told you about 2 minutes. So if this is you, then let's make this quick. And we're going to keep singing.
Oceans deep, a faithless.
Father, we need you. As far as we find ourselves, we need you. Lord, we declare this morning that we will put our faith in you, that we will put our trust in you. Lord, where things seem to be getting worse and worse, we'll still put our trust in you. And know that like King Nebuchadnezzar, when he said, there seems to be four people, not three. Lord, people will look at our lives and see it's not one or two. Father, we need you. Because only you can bring us out of fire. And Lord, I know that you give us a part to play in that, to put our faith in you. So each person that's standing here this morning, each person that's sitting down, Lord, we pray that we will have an evening faith. That's honest, that's gritty, that says no matter what, I'm still not going to bow. Even if I don't know the outcome. Because we know, Lord, that freedom is on the way. Freedom is on the way, God. Freedom is on the way, God. In every situation we find ourselves in, freedom is on the way. But until the freedom comes, we still trust. We still have faith. We still know, God, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Kings. We love you, Jesus. Because you went through the biggest fire for our freedom. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Straight after, can we have the next?